I've said all I need to for now. One of my people was monitoring the police radio. Very sloppy. I stated explicitly that you are not to kill any police officers. Their deaths attract attention, and we have to generate spin to attach the blame to natural causes. I'm losing my patience. What did you see on the ship? And the Ankaran sarcophagus? What did you see? Opened? Let's not jump to conclusions. Give me the manifest in your notes. I'll sort this mess later. You might have noticed when you came in, the parade of malingering mollycoddles filing out. Those with a primogen, this city's clan elders, a worrisome bunch devoted first and foremost to the security of their own skin, which is why they were here. It seems Alistair Grout, the Malkavian primogen, has either forgotten how to answer his phone, or is missing. Each minor problem like a grain of sand, each night I inherit the desert. The Sabbat's appearance has put the primogen on edge. Grout's mansion is in the Hollywood Hills. I need you to pry Grout out of whatever crack he's crawled into and have him contact us. Yes, for the moment. You know, your demeanor thus far bears similar characteristics to those that rise to the top of this organization. Stay that course. Yes, about Grout. As I said, Grout is the Malkavian primogen. His behavior and home are eccentric, to say the least. He's developed a paranoid bent lately, so you may have to check under every bed in the place for him. I suppose I can spare a few seconds. Yes? Which is? When we hear from Grout, you may come back. Until then.
Money, right? I got your cut right here.
Thank you. You? What are you doing here? No? You should get out of here. This place is bad news. Pardon me. You? What are you doing here? No? You should get out of here. This place is bad news. Pardon me.
Yes. It is quite peculiar, the happenings I've been made to witness for my supernatural longevity. I'm thinking of one unfortunate phenomenon in particular, of unique interest to my station, both as a professional and as a sufferer of this empiric condition. It seems the stream of time has begun to erode the moorings of my chosen course of study, for the methodologies that gave birth to psychology are slowly disappearing. I find myself in an era that overlooks the physical component of psychological pathology time and again in favor of the sadistic practices of Freud. Phrenology, dactopintalism, and the rest of the old guard has fallen by the wayside, its champions all silenced in death, with my unique exception. Would that I could make my voice heard again, although it may be suspicious should I return to popular medical discourse 50 years after my apparent death. No, better that I continue my studies into the psychoses in secret. One day may I hold up my own cure as validation of the methods. I am confident no cure for my condition or that of my beloved wife lies within our figurative minds, waiting to be unlocked by the correct combination of memories recovered from our childhoods. And I'm most certain it has nothing to do with the relationship between myself, my parents, and my genitals. Sorry, Sigmund, but I choose to stay my course. In time, too, may your star fade and disappear. Another unfortunate casualty to tide of time, insane asylum. I lament their loss not only as brokerage houses for the breadth and depth of human psychoses, but also I shall mourn the disappearance of that peculiar environment present only in an insane asylum, that palpable atmosphere of blistered brains and churning bowels, the odoriferous mélange of freely flowing bodily humors, that gently rolling cacophony of distant sobs and screams, the muttered cursing of perceived enemies, and the blissful gurgling of the lobotomized, like a newborn babe discovering the sky. I shall still find test subjects as surely as I find bloody sustenance in the night, but this climate, I fear, may never be replicated.
Thank you.
Often I reflect a deep regret on the missed opportunity that was my infector. Had I been conscious of the attack, I could have stopped the others from locking me in the bowling pin. One evil. Two simple questions of the plague-ridden woman. Of course, there was no guarantee she would have been any more helpful than my current cross subjects. Given the nature of the tests, I cannot expect the same fervor from all, but a modicum of cooperation would be appreciated. The one called John went so far as to gnaw off his arm, escaping the floorboards like some feral rodent. I still hear them scurrying about his neck. My studies proceed with a rage, and admire the foul long weed as my wife soon surmises. My subjects grow restless without proper supervision, but I cannot pull myself back to this. How many nights I've wasted now, gazing from the tower wall, pondering the frailty. After decades of solitary study into this affliction, I have learned that it is by no means my glory. Indeed, the city is home to an entire society of similarly afflicted individuals with whom I've only recently made contact. They are an understandably standoffish sort by and large, but I have been able to confirm with them that the condition is indeed ambiguous, which apparently comes in a multitude of strains, each with a spectacular set of symptoms such as invisibility and even a sort of lycanthropy. Through numerous official interactions with the governing body of this secret society, I have concluded that their fundamental understanding of the vampiric condition is woefully lacking, admired in suspicion and pseudo-religious dogma that would make a Turk balk for its fiction. Indeed, they seemed impressed with my studies and the eloquence with which I was able to present them. Apparently, the typical sufferer of my particular strain of vampirism is far from the vanguard of the king's English. So impressed were they that they even offered me an office in their government. High office, by the sound of things, I believe I shall accept. If nothing else, it should provide a lofty vantage point from which to observe the breadth and epidemiology of the affliction so that I may move more expeditiously toward a cure. I have accepted the role of Primogen for Clan Malkavian, the dreadfully winsome label applied to the particular strain of vampirism I suffer, so named for some supposed vampire father figure of old, or poppycock grown from a backward culture that seems interminably drawn to children's tales and the fiction of Victorian romance when it should concern itself with the science behind their suffering. For I have taken this office for no greater reason than to advance my research. I must make mention, however, that even among my would-be peers in this governing body of vampires, the level of paranoia and superstition is frightening. Their intelligence is not the question, no, indeed. As they courted me for this appointment, I had to suspect that their overtures were hand-tailored to what must be my obvious infatuation with reason, for the devil would well to have such honey-tongued tempters. Even so, I could not help but notice the dressing of language these vampire leaders chose for their siren song. Whether it is born of habit, from addressing their unwashed, ill-educated subjects, or from their own deep-seated beliefs, their linguistic flourishes belie faith and superstition over the provenance of empirical reason that must be an all-pervasive theme in this society of darkest night. Damn it all, now I'm doing it. As I expand my dealings with the vampire government, I have encountered a disturbing but new symptom of this future. Frequently, in conversation, I want their voices emanating from the vampires, voices that are not their own, but presume to have insight into their lives beyond what I could gather from simple conversation. These voices seem to echo from deep within my fellow vampires, and I cannot be certain if this symptom belongs to my strain of illness or theirs. The voices are various and inconsistent. I dare not mention this symptom to my vampiric peers, for they have proven themselves true predators to whom I could be loath to reveal any sign of weakness. Indeed, these voices have counseled me against confessing their presence, and until I can confirm their source, I will listen. The information of the voices have given me ranges from curious to frightening. The latter case is especially true of one powerful vampire whose name I shall not commit to recording in the interests of self-preservation. The voices have increased in frequency and direction of late. They have begun to stay with me long after conversation has ceased and are serving as quite a distraction. I fear others are beginning to notice my preoccupation at the vampire gatherings. I'm thinking again of the particular vampire of whom I spoke previously, who I dare not name for my growing fear. If the voices are to be believed, then my caution is warranted, for they speak of his blackest crimes, both past and future. More than once, I have seen the suspicion in his eyes and heard the distrust in his voice when speaking of me. The fear must register on my face, as it is all I can do in these moments to keep from crying out in chorus with the voices. I am no longer safe. I know it. The voices have proven themselves authentic, and I have withdrawn from the vampire society entirely. My absence will no doubt draw attention, but I could no longer hold my fragile composure around the ravenous eyes of my vampire peers, especially not around him. The voices compelled me to make what I fear is a Faustian bargain, but I had to, for their demands are constant and merciless. I have secluded myself within the mansion. I know he will strike out at me. He will go to any length to achieve his ambitions, and he knows it, I know. I have taken precautions to protect my beloved wife. The cure will have to wait until our immediate safety is guaranteed. The mansion was constructed with security in mind, but at that time I was not privy to the full range of vampire capabilities. The voices echo in the twisted corridors of my psyche. Dark whisperings of a macabre and formless menace, the approach of which portends an end to all of this.
Soul to that lake of fire. All agents of Satan shall return to whence they came.